Okay, here we go.
I would have loved a whiteboard, because one of the things you're going to learn about me is that I'm not linear. So I'm going to tell my stories in circles, okay? And this is a lifelong process for me, this lecture. And it's kind of, as I give it more and more, it changes. And I think it gets, hopefully gets better for you. You guys will tell me. So my name's Jann Murray-Garcia. I'm a pediatrician by training. Did you guys read my bio? Pediatrician by training, master's in public health as well. I haven't practiced since I had my second, Gabrielle. Haven't practiced clinically, but I'm a professor now at the Betty Irene Moore School of Nursing. And so I choose to make change. I feel like I've never stopped being a pediatrician, but I choose to make change on a more systemic level for some of the reasons you'll see here. Some of the things that I think are most pressing in the lives of children and communities do not happen one-on-one between pediatricians and families, or pediatricians and communities, or pediatricians and kids in that clinical setting. They happen on system levels. I want to talk about scripts today, and this is where I have to tell you, I don't know that I have anything about scripts in the session, okay? So, but this is how I'm evolving, and this is what people have found most helpful, okay? So if you could think about, what do we use scripts for, you guys? What do we use scripts for? You guys came to talk, right? People aren't just talking at you, right? What do we use scripts for?
A guide.
Say?
A guide.
A guide, good. Okay, and what else?
A way to do the same thing over and over again.
A way to do the same thing over and over again. Come on, I know I have some theater people here. Do I have some drama here? What do we use scripts for? A way to do the same thing over and over again? So that we can all be playing our parts, so that the outcome is the same, right? We're not going to start off with Fiddler on the Roof and end up with Tyler Perry. I Can Do Bad All by Myself. Anybody? You know what I'm saying? We're going to do the same play, right? So that's what I want to talk about today in terms of health disparities and how some of the scripts we learn very early in our lives are pretty faithfully reproduced. So now, in the year 2013, we got a black president. Things are going well. No, you can't find any racist anymore, right? But we have racialized outcomes still. Meaning that we can predict who gets a lesser quality of care, partly based on whether they're African American, Latino, poor, second language besides English being the most comfortable, right? But we can't find any slave owners or whatever else we say we aren't. We can't find them anywhere, right? Let me just, one commercial, not linear. I'm not talking about white people, I'm talking about all of us. All of us have internalized the scripts that we get played out, that generation after generation produce unequal results, whether it's in healthcare, the criminal justice system, school system. I'll show you the free market in the United States. Okay, so I want to talk about some of those scripts and how we can begin to recognize them even before we get into health profession school. How many hopeful physicians do we have here? So this is one reason why I do this, because wow, I get to impact all of you, hopefully. If you take out one thing from today, I will have been so impactful. Who else is in the room? Any nurses, please? Nurse leaders? Oh boy. Okay, and who else is in the room in terms of health professions? Great, pre-dental, got health disparities in dentistry, you know. Anybody else? Social work, fabulous. Also racialized outcomes, yep. And the Native American community knows about outcomes that are not favorable to their children compared to other people, African Americans the same. Disproportionately, our families are labeled as dysfunctional and our kids are removed and raised by the state. It's a script that's, if you ever read the autobiography of Malcolm X, it's a script that's been faithfully reproduced in our country. So my goal today is to talk about cultural humility, which I'm just a little bit famous for, like that much. Okay, no, it's a phenomenon. It's a distinction against versus compared with cultural competence, this notion that because you came to my session, you got it now. You know the 10 things you're going to do with the Cambodian patient. You know the 5 things you never do with the Mexican patient. Okay, forget about that. This is a lifelong process, you guys. A lifelong process. You will never have mastery in somebody else's culture or their life experience. So the issue is not competence for me. It's a stance of humility, where you are aware of your own scripts for that person. You are aware of the scripts they might bring to you. Maybe they are from a group that has been historically mistreated by institutions, or they're from a country. And you can know a couple things, but the rest, in the spirit of patient-centered care, you just got to develop a relationship for that person to tell you. That, for me, that's more about humility than it is about competence. In the end, they're just words, okay? So let's get started. How you can prepare now at UC Merced, UC Davis, San Diego, Dominguez Hills, I heard. How you can be doing that now. Okay, so we're gonna talk about cultural humility, probably towards the end, as an approach to excellent care of diverse populations. We'll discuss issues of race, power, and identity in ways that hopefully, perhaps you have not heard before, and how they can affect the care. Wow, why did I have that? Adolescent patients and any patients. And make visible those kind of unspoken social scripts we hold for the other and for ourselves that may impact our encounters. Thinking that in terms of scripts, that help us do the same thing over and over again, help us keep to a historical script, sometimes of inequality. If we can see that happening, if we can hear it in our heads, if we can problematize that with patients, with each others, with each other, with colleagues, if we see it and confront it, we can interrupt it and potentially transform it before you hurt someone or someone's family. Yeah? You guys with me? If I could get a little... When I say something, you're like, yeah, that's real, Dr. Murray. That's what's up. You know, we can't say amen because it's UC Davis, public university. You can't say amen. So just something. Give me something, people. I know it's hot. You guys had lunch. You know, I brought my coffee. Nap in a can. Right? So don't make me put you on blast because you fell asleep, okay? Okay, so let's talk about, there are all kind of disparities. I focus on race. I know people love to get me off race and say, well, what about class? And what about, you know, this and that? All very important. What about homophobia? Can we have a conversation about race for another half hour? Would that be okay? Okay, because I think I hope to teach a whole class on that next quarter. I think at some point we have to stay here for a second, however uncomfortable it is, and talk about race as a social concept. Not those people, not these people, these people, these people, not the quantitative data, but what do we mean when we say race? What do we live when we say, how do we live race? How do we teach it? How do we learn it? That's very different than what we usually talk about in terms of health disparities, right? You guys are all gonna put that in your essays, I know. What does it mean? Most of that work has been done on race, actually. So what do I mean when I say racial stratification? I didn't bring my short quiz, but let me, I know it by heart. Okay, I want you to guess this community for me. Guess this community, okay? This community of folks was brought as slaves to this country, not necessarily this country, but to the country I'm talking about, and has experienced second-class citizenship ever since. They live in different areas than other people. Their kids go to school in different schools. As a group, they score less high on standardized tests. They have higher dropout rates. Okay, they have worse health outcomes. Their communities experience more violence, more victimization that way. They end up in jail at higher rates than other people. What community am I talking about? What community am I talking about? You're not going to offend me.
African-American.
African-Americans? Okay, that's not who I'm thinking about, but okay. What other communities?
Underpoverished.
Okay.
Underpoverished.
Impoverished communities? Could be. It's not the one I'm talking about, but Native Americans definitely describes that. Good question. So actually, I'm talking about Koreans and Japan. Can't be a citizen of Japan if you're a Korean. You were brought to Japan as slaves. Everything I said about African Americans here, Native Americans, poor people of any race, including white people, is true of Koreans in Japan. You guys get that? So I know we like to problematize black people and black families, and we like to talk about those people who come over the border and mess it up and contaminate us, and that's why they have worse. But do you guys see, like, the invisible script of what is a minority and its relationship to a majority within a community? Majority never gets named, right? The dominant culture never gets problematized, right? In fact, you can't find majority folks who are perpetuating this, or minority folks for that matter. Both are true. But that script is faithfully reproduced. So we're not talking about African Americans in Oakland. We're not talking about new immigrant Mexicans in North Carolina. We're talking about systems. Do you guys see that? A script that is as historical as it is present day. Anybody? So do we talk about then and problematize and intervene in the lives of the disadvantaged, in the underserved, the underprivileged? Is it just that they need to be fixed? Or is it a system in which all of us are implicated, in which we all silently reproduce, whether we know it or not, myself included, okay? We all have implicit bias, we all have hidden bias. Our institutions are scripted. You know how white people got to be feeble-minded in the 1920s during eugenics? You know how they, Eastern and Southern Europeans, none of whom you can find today, so it's a phenomenon of white people today, however you culturally celebrate your ethnicity, the social construction is of a white people. We don't talk about the trouble that white ethnic groups had coming here. We don't talk about the Irish anymore. We don't talk about and how they were indentured slaves or indentured servants alongside black people. We don't talk about the Greek people in the 1920s or the Italians Remember what WAP means? It's a slur for Italians. Without papers. Does that sound familiar? Is that a script we use today? For who? Same script, different group. Powerful, right? Powerful. Guys, if you can see yourself as playing a role, who created this script? Who's controlling all this? It's a fascinating thing. Who is it? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know, but it's pretty fascinating that we all get it. That we all get when somebody labeled us model minorities, all of a sudden we're living up and we're living down to the more problematic minorities, minor citizens, right? But the way that white ethnic groups were problematized in the early 20th century as people we needed to tolerate for labor, but they were never suitable for American citizenship or the practice of democracy. So standardized testing came about in the early 20th century. It's a great story if you read the big test. We used to rank white ethnic groups by their standardized test scores. Never mind they didn't know English very well. But the implicit cultural bias in our standardized tests, which has been really documented, labeled some of us as less than, as minority whites. It's crazy, right? We don't hold this collective narrative anymore. We don't hold it anymore. We talk about standards and qualifications decontextualized from the history. And the script goes on and on and on. Inculcated within our institutions. Can't see it anymore. Can't even see the script anymore, right? That doesn't mean you shouldn't study for your MCATs, people. Okay, we got to play that. All right. So, wow. Really? Seriously? Koreans in Japan? Dang. I thought you were talking about African Americans here. Crazy, right? So, if you get nothing, just one or two things you get out of this. There was a geneticist, unfortunately from Berkeley, and yes, I spelled it wrong on purpose. Yeah, I was telling from Stanford. Go Cardinal, okay. Stanford geneticist said, race is not something our chromosomes do to us. Race is something we do to each other. So when you're looking at health disparities, you guys, when you're reading these articles about who has this and who has diabetes and who has glaucoma more and who goes blind from glaucoma more, don't necessarily limit yourself to biology. In fact, I would say at this point, biology has very little to do with it. I'm not talking about sickle cell, I'm not talking about Tay-Sachs, which are chromosomal abnormalities with geographic reasons to persist. Okay, you guys know that? If you haven't learned that, you will. That's different than a group of black folks or a group of Latin folks who come here and their health deteriorates as a people. That is a social construction, something we do to each other. And I'm starting to think of it more like scripts that we live. Okay, so I talked about this, how Jews became white folks. And what that says about whiteness of a different color, how the Irish became white. So in the 1700s, Benjamin Franklin and company found themselves, it was just the British. The Irish were here. Any Irish folks? The Irish were here to work. Often they got here because their travel was paid here, and then they were indentured servants. In the South, they worked right alongside African slaves, okay? And in fact, Africans, before race became how you determine who was a slave or not, were here as indentured servants. They were free Africans in the 1600s. When we needed more people to build a country who wouldn't leave and actually who wouldn't get paid, then it became about race. Too easily for the Irish to assimilate. Native Americans, you can't find them. They know the country too well, and there's thousands of miles on the other side. Who can we find? That was a deliberate decision to enslave Africans. to have them be slaves. And then there was the social scripts of, well, because, all the reasons, right? They don't have souls, they like working out in the heat, they enjoy being slaves, actually. All those scripts that got taught to perpetuate that system, even as we knew it was problematic. So in the 1700s, the British folks, who were truly British, were the white or dominant culture now. They're like, wow, there are a lot of black and Native Americans here. We are going to be overrun. In fact, Charleston, where my family's from, South Carolina, one out of four African Americans who came, whose ancestors came here through slavery, came through Charleston. So it was the most vicious form of slavery in the United States because, quite frankly, there were more Africans than white people in South Carolina. Okay? So Benjamin Franklin and company looked around and said, where can we get some more white people? Knowing that the British were elite, you know? Okay, they didn't like the Irish. If you look in the literature and in the artwork, Irish folks were characterized as apes and monkeys. Savage is what they were called. Anybody recognize that script that we use for other folks? Okay, so, and they were Catholic. Ew, right? So the British didn't like them, but they didn't have any choice. The Danish also, who had settled slash stole Manhattan in that area, they said to the Danish, about the Danish, well, they come here and they work for less wages and they make it harder for us British people to earn a living. Hello? Does that sound familiar? It's a present day script. No, it's pretty old. You got to recognize it as such. Okay, the Germans? No, please no. Benjamin Franklin, who is from Pennsylvania, said they come here and they want to make Pennsylvania Germantown. They even want bilingual education. We cannot have them be us. They are them. True story. Look under Ronald Takaki, please. Look under Glazer from Harvard, Glazer. Crazy, right? The scripts that were there. They had no choice. They needed white people based on skin, not based on biology. So the naturalization law of 1790 made all Irish, Danish, and German people, and anybody else who was here, who was white, what was white? I don't know, you look white. All white men, ladies, not you, are now citizens. Right? We made it up. We made it up, you guys. We made whiteness up. And I know there are a lot of us in the room, and I talked, I don't consider myself white. Well, you may not, but that's the script that's put on you. Just like the script that's put on my son is that he will be a criminal. He will be hypersexual. Hold your purse in the elevator. Are you really in an advanced placement class, Gabrielle? He plays that script now, but it's challenged often. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's unusual. You're an unusual black person, a credit to your race. You're not following the scripts. Hello? Okay, so yeah, race is dynamic. What is white has changed over time. Those of you of Irish descent, especially of any kind of Eastern European Jewish descent, you're a new white person in the history of this country, relatively speaking. Greeks, you got it? Okay, this is Ronald Takaki. I'm going to give you some homework to do over the next 20 years, okay? But to just tell you, this is the breakdown of, I wish I could do this bigger, but it doesn't reproduce, of superior intelligence based on standardized tests. Okay? And we've got commissioned officers, we've got people from England, Scotland, up and up, Poland down here, even lower than blacks, Italians. You guys got the picture? Okay, Russian, Slavic, any Slavic people? Feeble-minded. So you were tracked in school based on that. The measurement. Were the people flawed or was the measurement flawed? Hello? Okay. Racist dynamic. When I was growing up, a hoodie was the top part of a running suit. Now it's a signal, a social construction for someone we should fear. How did that happen? Folks born and raised in the United States of Middle Eastern descent in New England, I didn't grow up with Middle Eastern people being terrorists or South Asian people being terrorists. That was not a social construction we had. 1972, we had the Olympics and the Iranian, the Palestinian, sorry, hostage crisis. But those were Palestinians angry at Jewish people. This is a new thing where you walk through an airport and you look Middle Eastern and you're, this is a new social construction we have. Okay? So these people were students in Ivy League colleges up and down the East Coast. The New York City police thought it was good to infiltrate their Muslim student organizations. So they would go, they would pretend to be students and then go to retreats and report back what people were saying. Nothing ever came of it. There were no terrorists. But you get the point? We have a script for certain people. So race is about superficial characteristics that we subconsciously believe tell us something about the essence or potential of a person. It might be that hypertension being higher in African Americans is not about their biology. It might be about the system that minoritizes us. Maybe that's where our research needs to be. Maybe that's where our policy needs to be. So people are looking now at genetic markers for aggression and criminality. Who do you think that's going to affect more? Where do we learn race? When do we learn race? Hello?
Kids.
When do we learn race? Who said very, very early? That's some good sleuthing, dude. That's good. Okay. Yeah, very early. I want to show you a film. It's 1 minute long. It's of about third graders, something like that. Look how racially diverse the group is. This is not about white people, even though it says white supremacy. To me, it's not about white people. And we might have to play this twice because usually the...
We brought together three groups of
you guys
kids
got
at a
it?
Day camp and
oh, good.
Showed them pictures of two men, one Arab, the other Asian. Who do you like better, this man or this man?
The Chinese guy.
Over and over.
How do we know
he's
like Chinese?
The Asian man more than the Arab.
Looks meaner and he looks nicer.
Because he looks nicer?
Yeah, he does look nicer. And he has a smile on.
But both men are smiling. And what do the kids think about the personalities of the men?
Let me ask, you don't know this person, but what do you think he's like?
I think he's weird.
Why is he weird?
He just doesn't look like a very nice person,
He looks like a scary dude.
He's on the phone. What's he talking about?
Maybe a robbery?
Then I ask about the Asian man. What's he like?
He looks like a regular teenager to me.
We then showed the pictures of a black man and a white man. What were some comments about the black man?
He looks mean. FBI most wanted.
He looks mean.
like he's a basketball player.
So, tell me about this guy. Seems like a nice person.
I think he's nice, except he might be mad about something.
He was probably picking up on something. This is Oklahoma City bomber Timothy McVeigh. But when we ask which man is a criminal, most kids pointed to the black man. And when we asked which was a teacher, they said,
that one! The guy in the green shirt.
Okay. So I don't need to play that again. Unless you want to see it again. It's like a minute long, minute and a half. Thoughts?
I think we're good.
You think we're good?
Yeah.
Thoughts?
I'm a teacher and I have a second grade student and she already demonstrated something very much like that.
So, and we could all probably pick out one kid in our life for whatever reason was parroting their parents or whatever. We usually say it's the parents. It starts with the parents. I bet you if you took this very diverse group of kids, their parents would say, they don't hear that at home sincerely, and it would be true. That's not the ethic of our family. And it would be true. Where does it come from, you guys? It's in the air, right? It's just in the air. It's in what we experience. How many of you experienced this in K through 12 schools? Where there were certain people who were AP students and certain people who were special education. There were kids who got suspended more for the same behavior and kids who didn't. So-and-so wouldn't do that. And part of that demarcation was by race. The implicit bias that sees the same behavior, you guys, and interprets it differently. Actually, different behavior and interprets it differently. Different skin color means different things to us. So let me tell you that the African American gentleman is a professor at Harvard. This one, perpetrator of the greatest act of domestic violence in the history of the United States. But the only thing that was different about them, how did the kids know that by fourth grade? How do we come, I mean, because they're all like, oh yeah, what did we know about the black man? What do we know about his career choices? Nothing, but we did know his skin color. So what did the kids say he could be when he grew up? Two career choices. Professional, athletics, and criminal. Hello? That's a pretty faithful script, right? No, I am not looking at you. What is your name?
Me?
Yeah.
Steven.
Where are you from, Steven?
Cal Poly.
All right, I had my sister went there and all that. What are you studying, dude?
Biology.
Yeah. Want to be a doctor?
Trying to be.
Dude, you are not being looked at. I know what you're thinking. No, I'm not messing with you, Steven, but it's uncomfortable, right? Yeah. You guys are sweating, my white men are sweating. It's just like, here we go again. Do you get that this is not about you up here, even though the social construction is that you are up here? You guys know that precedes you by hundreds of years? You know that the Constitution afforded rights to white men who own property. That is not your fault. That's not your fault. But it's a pretty, how we came to protect and expand that property does precede you. Yeah? And has been melted and inculcated and insidiously reproduced within schools and homes and media. Everybody get that's not Stephen's fault. Can we let Stephen go so he can learn along with us and not have to say, dude, that was, that workshop, Okay, that's about all of us. In fact, I would say in terms of personal responsibility, and please don't let this be the only thing that you remember, my African-American little brothers and sisters are doing the best they can to faithfully reproduce the order because that's what they learned about themselves. And when they tried to resist, they were punished by the institution. Or somebody said, true story, wow, I've never met any a black person in AP calculus. What does that do to your mind as a little kid? Question yourself, question your race, distance yourself from your race, or just go, you know what, dude, you don't get out enough. That's what that's about. My people were going to college in the 1800s, even before the end of slavery. We were the first advocates for public school education in the South. It wasn't about white people, it was about aristocracy. We don't care what color they are. If they're not stupid, they won't work, right? If they have other options, we don't get our crops and our manufacturing in the South and the North done, right? That's why we could problematize those of you who are Greek American, hello? Those of you who are Irish American. Because as long as you believe the social construction about yourself, and as long as the institutions perpetuate that, we get a labor supply and our wealth increases. So I really need Stephen to feel like you are not the problem. Our system is the problem. And in your generation, because I grew up in 63, Dr. King was killed when I was 5. We have so many questions about, well, is it really the institutions and the systems, or is it really that they're not trying hard enough and they don't have fathers? A lot of us don't have fathers. Do you know how many men of all races don't pay child support? Just because you married that person doesn't. So 70% of black folks don't marry, what's the point? 50% of us will be divorced. Do you see what I'm saying? It's arbitrarily assigned to us. Okay, I want to leave time for questions, okay? And that's the end of my talk, essentially, except that I want to give you a few solutions. But none of them are going to be done today. And you can't buy it at Walmart or Walgreens or Harvard or any place else. Cultural humility is a lifelong process of learning to see those scripts, sometimes hear those scripts. It's a lifelong process. Some of you, when you leave here, you will feel guilty. Some of my Asian brothers and sisters will say, well, it's not my fault we're the model minority, and we do, da, 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 da. That's not what I'm talking about. You guys got that? Whether your time, think about the children, whatever race or ethnicity they are. We're just born the same naked people. The only difference is our genitalia, right? How is it that some of us are born into a set of social statements that expects us to do? You guys get that? So I'm not blaming anybody. It's a system. We're so scripted to think, wait, if we change that, doesn't that mean we get less? Or if they get more, doesn't that mean that kind of zero-sum thinking? Is there a different way to think about it? That's all I'm asking. Okay, I know you got to succeed in the system that's here and now. That's a true story. But really make it a lifelong commitment to hear how you're fitting in, to hear how your patients who are disproportionately this or that, suffering from this and that, not trusting the healthcare system, not trusting. Instead of that script, I don't know what's wrong with them. I wasn't a slave owner. I don't know what's wrong with them. They don't trust me. Can you see the script now? And see, it's not about you or them. It's about give that patient a reason to say, you know the script, and you're going to transform it right here and now with this clinical encounter or with this clinical relationship over many years. Part of that is redressing power imbalances in the patient-clinician dynamic. So that is not that patient's responsibility to trust you. because you're a nice person, because you're a Christian, because you're an observant Muslim, because you went to South America or Latin America and learned Spanish. People don't give up. They're living their own scripts of intergenerational trauma and unequal treatment. It is your responsibility to diffuse the power imbalance. And I could write a whole book on how we do that. Okay? Developing mutually beneficial and non-paternalistic clinical and advocacy partnerships with communities. So transforming the script of we use this population for research. I'm going to go to Houston to train because, man, you get to do a lot of stuff. Which for some of us translated means there must be a lot of poor colored folk coming into your hospital whom you have no intention of serving once you get your BMW. You know what I'm saying? Hear that script. I'm going to go to L.A. County because nobody in my family ever had to go to L.A. County. I grew up with health insurance, solidly middle class. Think about that, how the system puts you in the position of practicing on people who have no choice. That doesn't mean don't go there. That means dare to be the one that transforms the value system that reflects. Hello? Okay, so I'm going to give you, I have just this one thing, and then we'll talk. And I know my women over here have been dying to say something to me, and I'm sorry, they give me this thing, I got to do it 4 times in a row, and I got to leave you guys 15 minutes to talk, and I already took 3 minutes. Please forgive me so I don't answer questions during the talk. And it is hot in here, and I've lost some people I lost. I'm not going to embarrass you. When they're not filming in the next 3 sessions, I will be waking people up. This session I'm not, because it's going to be broadcasted internationally, and that's messed up. Right? So, okay, so here's my homework for you. I had one person last year take me up on this that I know of, actually more than one, but one person who was emailing me a lot about what he was learning, white man. Love him to death, still in contact with him. Here's your homework. Anybody know why I three-hole punched it? Why did I three-hole punch that? Why would you do that? Because it's your homework for the next 20 years. This is the start, not the finish. If you say, oh no, I'm good, I know that stuff, because I heard Dr. Jann Murray-Garcia for 35 minutes talk about it, I will deny I was ever in the country. I will tell you that on October 11th, 12th, 2013, I was on Vancouver Island, Canada. Okay? We have not solved any problems here. When you walk out, you're going to be agitated, disturbed, guilty, sad, feel helpless, trapped. You know what I'm saying? So the solution isn't anything I can give you. And don't feel like I need to see that you really are not the person in there. Please don't try too hard, because we're all that person, myself included. In fact, I think I might be the biggest racist in the room, because I study and think about this stuff all the time. Hello? Do you guys feel free? Do you guys feel like I'm not looking at anybody? There was this one guy, Steven. No, I'm just messing with you. Okay, so here we go. These are my favorite books. Did you like my talk? These are my favorite, if you trust me, these are my favorite books. Ronald Tokaki, A Different Mirror, Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together? Blink by Malcolm Gladwell. Anything by Malcolm Gladwell. 40 Ways to Raise a Racist Non-Racist Child. The Bully, the Bullied, and the Bystander. Wow, why that one? It's a form of bullying, right? Yes. It's part of how we do community in the United States. And the only thing that has ever changed life for anybody, whether it was women, boopadoop, or people standing, stepping out of the bystander role. Okay, so you got to read that book. It was written for 11-year-olds. I think it's more a high school, college, adult book. Miss Evers Boys is about the Tuskegee syphilis experiment. Please do not go to medical school or apply to medical school without seeing this movie. You can get it for $6 on Amazon. You will not be taught about this Tuskegee syphilis experiment. You will not be taught. You go to an exceptional medical school if they ever mention it. It's pathetic, okay? Okay, what's my brother in the Burgundy?
Gabe Casillas. I'm with your guy, Steven, at Cal Poly.
All right. I'm your guy, huh? You said, I'm with your guy, Steven. Thank you, Gabe, for your attention. He said, but Gabe is like, huh? Until I snapped it out. That's why I'm messing with you, dude. You got to do it. You got to do it. It's the best nonfiction movie. It's a movie. It's a cinema. But and I usually don't like them, you know, because it's kind of based on, and it is. But every story illustrates a historical truth of that era. And then you'll learn more about it. Race, the Power of an Illusion, the first part, part one. Okay? You doing good? You doing good? We know each other, huh? Yeah, we do. Do we? No? Okay. Thank you, though, for trying to pretend. Community in the Classroom is a movie I produced with the young people in Davis, California, about how Davis, California has excellent schools, the top 10% in the state, marked racial disparities. The kids will tell you, of all races, how they have learned race, how they have learned to expect different things from each other. Please watch that movie. I actually think that Facebook is a tool of the devil. That being said, please like us on Facebook if you like that movie. The movie is free on YouTube, so you guys got it. You know how you post it, and I can never do that, because you know, you guys post it and it's uploaded. Yay, go ahead, do what you want with it. Mine just goes whoop, 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 whoop. So I don't do that, and I don't do Facebook, because as I mentioned, I think it's a tool of the devil. Okay, so, and I'm joking. You guys are all serious. Look, she's like, oh my God, I think she really believes it. Questions, comments, feelings?
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, say your name, please, and where you're from.
Camille from Stanford. What's an actionable...
What's your major in?
I'm a graduate student in earth science.
Fabulous that you're here.
Yeah. What's an actionable, small... action that you think would be a good takeaway?
Something we can do differently.
Okay, so you want me to solve the problem. You want a recipe.
I want one of the smallest tools from your toolkit that you could give us.
I know that you read, right? I'm dead serious. I think what you could do is go back to Stanford, put an ad in the, whatever the news, the Daily, the whatever it was. What's the newspaper called?
I don't know. It's okay. All online now.
Okay, so are you trying to say I'm old? So, and get a diverse group of people to start reading these books together. What would I start with? 40 Ways to Raise a Non-Racist Child. Because it's for parents, they're 5-minute chapters. I tell parents you can read it on the way to sleep, but it's going to show you how you got the file cabinet from your parents, how they sorted people, you know what I'm saying? So it's for parents to say, here's what your kids are going to face, here's what this, you know, here's what happens when kids of color go to non-diverse schools. It's really a hard choice to make. I made it for my kids in Davis. It's been in some ways wonderful, in some ways it's been a psychological disaster. So, but you'll learn about, written by a white woman and an African-American woman, you'll learn about how we have to think differently about our kids and how we have to raise our kids differently. What's the problem? Well, it's 5 till. Tell them to settle down. You're a teacher. You're a teacher, dude. There you go. What's your name? Say?
Kian.
Kian, and where are you from?
Israel.
Israel. Wow. And where are you teaching here?
Yeah.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Where are you teaching?
I teach at C2 Education, and I do some volunteer teaching at Taft High School.
And how long have you been in the United States?
8 years.
So when I said, where are you from? Why did you say Israel?
That's where I'm from.
Okay.
I mean, how recently?
No, but I don't, you know, sometimes I ask people, where are you from? Where are your people from? Where, and they think, oh, China? And I'm like, no, no. I know people ask you that all the time. How long have you been in the United States? Dr. Takaki? His family's been here 100 years in Hawaii. So he starts that book, which I think every American should read. Again, short chapters, with the story of how he's a tenured professor. It's not about class at Cal. He gets off. He gets off of a plane and goes is on his way to a multicultural conference. And the cab driver, I won't even tell you the race of the cab driver, says to him, "Wow, they're having a great conversation." And then the cab driver says, "How long you been in the United States? Do we have that script that American means white?" And then other people have to justify themselves, right? So that's why I'm sensitive to that, because I've really tried to hear that script before I put it on somebody. No, that's good. That's good. But this is a practical thing. Hear the script. Start to hear the script. I can't sell you anything. There's not a pen that's going to have. There's no code cards that are going to tell you the 10 things you need to do when you walk out of here. It's a lifelong process, depending on the resources you have, the population you're working with, if you've even cultivated a diverse circle of friends. Please do not run up to the first black person you see and say, "Dude, you need to be in my book club." We don't use people like that, okay? If you have not been respectful to people, you will need 2, 3, 4, 5 years to get the kind of education you need to serve the diverse population. Do you guys got it? Don't compel the Latino club to be in coalition with you. Whatever you are, black, white, but you guys got it? Yeah, go ahead, dude.
I was just wondering what your take was on affirmative action.
I think for physicians, we know that, I'm gonna talk about healthcare because we have 2 minutes. And they're settled down. You're really good. Good for you. It's a huge issue, right? It's a huge issue. Which should start with, what do you mean by affirmative action? Okay? But I will tell you very quickly, I think qualifications, what qualifies you to be a physician in our country, should be expanded. And things be weighted based on what Americans need. We all need excellent physicians. That is not the same as saying, however high your MCAT scores or your grade point average, those make the better physicians. Some of the worst, most arrogant, most lazy people I have ever met had the highest scores. I believe in terms of affirmative action, there is a floor above which we know people will make it through medical school. I think that we can serve the public by having a diverse group of students in medical school who will teach all of us, and a diverse group of faculty who you need, you guys. You need to learn how to treat people, how to recognize those scripts. Dude, do you know what you just said to so-and-so? Or do you know how that looked? Or do you need to be in close relationship with people like that? So that, for me, affirmative action is, what do the people need? And then what needs to be in place so that you get that as a medical student? Like I said, with the big test by Nicholas Lehman and the eugenics movement, of which standardized testing is a legacy, we are not picking out that group of physicians. Not to mention, I haven't even talked about how much more likely physicians of color, Latino and African American and Native American, are to serve people who will never see you again after medical school, depending on who you are. That hurts all of us. So if affirmative action means, you know, we need to make sure that we enrich the educational environment for all students, and we need to know that people haven't just done service projects, but they are committed in their soul to going back to their communities, that's good for all of us. Okay? Do your homework. I'll check back with you in a couple decades. I'm on the net, so email me. I do not, please don't call me to do research or anything like that, you guys, okay? Because I'm full that way. Thank you, sir.